Hey guys, I'm Lee Morris with FStoppers.com, and in front of me here are the five most popular laptops out right now. I'm personally looking for the ultimate laptop so that I can go out on the road and edit with Adobe Premiere. Hopefully after the test we do today, we will be able to pick a winner. Let me tell you about the five laptops that we have. I have them set up in order according to price. We'll start on the left with the most expensive. This is the Surface Book. It has a Core i7-6600U, which is a dual core processor. All of the laptops have 16 gigabytes of RAM. This laptop also has a GTX 965M graphics card. Next up, we have the laptop that I personally am the most excited about, which is the HP ZBook Studio G4. This thing just came out. It's supposed to have an incredible 4K monitor. It has tons of ports, including Ethernet, which is super important to me. It has an i7700HQ. And then for a graphics card, it actually has a workstation Quadro M1200. Now, as you guys know, I am not a big Mac user, but yesterday Apple just came out with updated MacBook Pros with the new Kaby Lake processors. So I thought, why don't I go ahead down to the Mac store? I'm going to buy one of these and I will throw it into the mix as well. This one also has a i7-7700HQ processor, 16 gigabytes of RAM, but for the graphics card, it has a Radeon Pro 555. Now, I also purchased a Dell Inspiron 7000. This is Dell's cheaper gaming laptop, but it also has really high-end specs, and it actually might be the most incredible bang for your buck when it comes to value. This thing has the exact same processor as the last two computers, the 7700HQ. It also has the 16 gigabytes of RAM, and for the graphics card, it has a GTX 1050 Ti, which is incredible, especially for the price of this thing at just $1,400. And finally, on the far right, this has been our workhorse for about a year and a half now. This is the Dell XPS 15. We really do love this laptop. This is the 9550 version. They are currently up to the 9560 version that has the Kaby Lake processors. This is the older version, which means that it has the 6700HQ processor in it, which is slightly slower at 2.6 gigahertz. And for the graphics card, it has a GTX 960M. So now that you know the basic laptops that we have here for this test, let me show you what I actually did to compare the rendering speed of each of these computers. I grabbed the exact same Adobe Premiere file. I put them on all of the laptops. I got the newest Adobe Premiere. I queued each of them up with the exact same specs in Media Encoder. And the reason why I chose this project was because it's got a range of different footage shot on different cameras, shot in 1080, some shot in slow-mo, some shot in 4K. Tons of different effects were used in this timeline, so I thought it would be a good render test. So for the very first test, I turned on GPU acceleration, which should render faster times, and I went ahead and just hit render on each of the five computers, and I timed it on my iPhone. To my surprise, the fastest laptop was the oldest and cheapest laptop, which was the XPS 15. I was shocked to see that, and funny enough, the next fastest computer was the next cheapest computer, which was the Dell 7000. Next up was the ZBook, which was kind of a surprise to me, being that it was really the most expensive and should have been the most powerful computer of the bunch. After that, the Surface Book finished, which was a total shock to me because it's the only laptop that I tested that had a dual core processor. And then the slowest by far to finish was the MacBook Pro. So after this test, I was a little confused. I was shocked that the MacBook was the slowest, but I thought maybe there was some issue with Adobe not working with the graphics card or something, and maybe that's why it was the slowest. So what I did was I turned off graphics acceleration on all five computers and I did the test again, which means that it's using only the processor to actually encode the video. And to my surprise, it made no difference on any of the computers. And I've certainly exported projects before on our desktop machines where I have seen significant differences in time exporting with the GPU rather than just the CPU. But for some reason with this project, and I don't know why, it just didn't seem to affect anything having the GPU turned on. We got almost identical times with the second test. The other strange thing about this test was that three of the computers had the exact same processor, and they had very different times when it came to encoding. And so I don't understand that either. I've read some interesting benchmarks comparing the new Kaby Lake processors to the older versions. And even though on paper they are supposed to be like 10 to 20% faster, in real world benchmark tests, that may not actually be the case. And we seem to have proven it today because for some reason, the laptop that is 1.5 years older than all the rest is actually the fastest when it comes to encoding in Adobe Premiere. So now that you know which one is fastest when it comes to rendering, let me go through each of these laptops and I'm going to give you a quick little review of my thoughts after using these things for a few weeks in some cases, a few years in others, and when it comes to the MacBook, only a few minutes. Let's start with the cheapest of the bunch, the XPS 15. The only reason that this thing is the cheapest is because it's the oldest. They do make a new version of this laptop, which is almost identical to this, but it does have updated hardware inside. Keep in mind though, we've just proven that updated hardware may not always be the best thing. I am a huge fan of this laptop. We've had this thing as our main machine for pretty much a year and a half at this point. My only complaint about this laptop is that it doesn't have Ethernet, and I don't think that it's possible to put Ethernet in this thing just because it is so thin. And the speakers on this machine don't sound great. Now, when it comes to the actual build quality of this thing, I love it. It's made of aluminum on the top and bottom. And then inside, it's made of like, I don't know, this soft touch carbon fiber thing. I didn't think I really liked the look of it, but in terms of the way that it feels, I do really like it. The keyboard feels awesome. I'm a big fan of the keyboard. The touchpad works well for Windows, but you know, it's nothing to brag about by any means. Probably my favorite feature of this entire laptop is the screen itself. It has the thinnest bezel on any laptop I think I've ever seen in my life, and it's a 4K touchscreen. I don't really use the touchscreen, but it is nice to have it as a feature if you want it. But the colors and the sharpness and the crispness of this screen is just fantastic. Now let's talk about the Dell 7000 gaming laptop. As you can see, this thing is a little bit bigger than the last one, but for me, as somebody who doesn't use a laptop as his main machine, and I'm not one to really travel around with a laptop, basically like I'll have it in my bag and then I just set it down when I get to a location and I leave it there for the duration of my stay. I don't really mind if a laptop's that big, and I was really excited because it had Ethernet. So I got this thing, I turned it on, and I immediately noticed there is a problem with the colors on the screen on this thing, and it drives me absolutely crazy because this is the 4K version of this laptop. I've read horrible reviews of the 1080 screen on this laptop. So people were like, do not buy it if you know you get the 1080 screen, get the 4K screen. So I got the 4K screen thinking, this is perfect, this is exactly what I want. And the colors are just weird and muted and like not accurate at all. And I am not a pixel peeper. I do not care about calibrating monitors. I've never calibrated a monitor in my life. I don't care about any of that. But the second I turned this on, I just felt like something was wrong with this machine. It's the strangest, most inaccurate monitor I've seen in years, which is crazy. But everything else about this machine, I really did like. I don't mind the size of it. The keyboard's really nice. The trackpad works. I like the fact that it has the number pad on it. This computer itself is missing Thunderbolt, but to be honest, like I don't have a single thing that uses Thunderbolt, so that wasn't a big deal to me at this moment. There was one more issue with this machine, though, that I never would have dreamed would have been a problem, and that is the fact that the SD card reader in the side is significantly slower than all of the other laptops that we tested. We were getting around 80 to 90 megabytes per second transferring this project from an SD card onto the hard drive of each of these computers, except for this one. It was maxing out at 25 megabytes per second. And as somebody who shoots like gigabytes and gigabytes, maybe even terabytes of footage at a time, and I'm trying to transfer it over through the laptop to our little mini server, that was a deal breaker for me right away. Never in my life did I think that I would have to worry about the speeds of the card reader, but this one seems to have a problem and therefore I am shipping it back. All right, now let's talk about the MacBook Pro. As you guys know, I'm not a Mac user. However, I'm a huge fan of the design of Apple products. I love my iPhone, I love my iPads, and I love the design of most Apple laptops as well. Now, when you pick this thing up, it is shockingly thin. And if I could have a laptop that was this thin and did everything I wanted to do, I would definitely want this. I mean, this is the coolest looking laptop ever. But of course, the first thing that you'll notice, and for some reason Chelsea, she owns an older Mac laptop. She was like, wait a minute, there's no USB in this? No, there's no USB, there's no nothing. It's USB-C, and dealing with the dongles with this has been an absolute nightmare. We have been trying to do some screen recording through hardware with other Apple products, and I don't want to get into it right now, but dongles are like the worst thing in the world to me. Apple and Windows dongles. I hate them all. They're super unreliable, and now the confusion with Thunderbolt and USB-C, and the fact that, like, yes, they have the same connector, but it's not the same cable, and some Thunderbolt cables can transfer power and some can't, and some can transfer. There's just so much confusion when it comes to these cables. If you don't believe me, look it up. Look up USB Type-C confusion. I've read about it for hours. It's an absolute nightmare. So anyway, that alone is a reason for me not to buy this laptop, because I don't want to deal with the dongles. This thing also doesn't have an SD card reader, and that is a must for me, because everything we film on is SD. I don't want to have to carry around a card reader. It's just something else that I have to remember. Now, when you open up this thing, the trackpad on it is gigantic. And I have to say, the trackpad itself works amazingly well, and the Force Touch is really quite amazing, the way that it works. It's the best trackpad ever. There's no Windows comparison. The keyboard on this laptop is very strange. It's super flat, the key travel is so minuscule, and like the sound is like this hollow plastic tapping. I don't know. It's unlike any keyboard that I've ever used before. I can't say that I necessarily hate it, but it's something that would take me a little while to get used to for sure. I think if I had to choose a keyboard that I like the best, it would probably be the XPS 15 or the Surface Book. I really like the Surface Book keyboard as well. So this one feels very strange, but it may be something that you could get used to. When it comes to the touch bar, I think it's kind of gimmicky, but I have to say, when it comes to like using the audio slider, I do really like using that. That alone kind of makes me enjoy the touch bar. But the fact that it's always changing with every application that you open or whatever, to me, it just seems like if they're not going to implement this in every keyboard they make from now on, then it's always going to be a gimmick, and it may be something that they just remove from computers in a year or two. A lot of people claim that Mac laptops and Mac hardware in general just work so much better than Windows hardware, even though in many cases it's the exact same hardware. I will say that the second I opened up Premiere, it crashed on me. So everybody who says, oh my gosh, your computer's crashing because of Windows, no, I think it's crashing because of Adobe. I think Adobe is the real reason that it's crashing. So when it comes to unreliability and stuff like that, every time I've used a Mac, I get them to crash just as much as I do Windows. So I'm not sure that's a legitimate argument. I will say that the speakers on the MacBook Pro are my favorite of all of the laptops that I've tested. They're much fuller and richer sounding. They obviously don't have tons of bass, but it just sounds so much more pleasant to listen to these. I think I would be much more likely to use the speakers in this laptop rather than put headphones on compared to any of the other laptops that I tested. The screen on the MacBook is fantastic as well. The bezel isn't quite as thin as the bezel on the XPS 15, but it's still quite good. And basically, I love the minimal design of this thing. It's really, really nice. But of course, once we did the benchmark test and it was by far the slowest computer, I can't really figure out why. I don't know why, and I'm sure everybody in the comments, all of the Apple fans in the comments, will tell me what I did wrong. But guys, at least in this test, it's the slowest. So I will be happy to return this to the Apple Store today. So this is the HP ZBook, and I was very excited about this laptop. I bought this laptop with the intention of keeping this thing as my main machine. And the reason why I liked it so much was because it had the internal specs that I want, but it also has all of the external jacks. I mean, look at the jacks on this thing. It's got USB Type 3. It's also got Ethernet here. And then it also has HDMI and two Thunderbolt ports. That's crazy for a laptop. This is the most complete laptop I've ever seen when it comes to ports. It has everything you could possibly need. I love the design of the laptop too. It's got this like slick gray design, which is really, really cool, but it does grab fingerprints very easily. You open this thing up and it's really nice looking. It kind of looks like a MacBook Pro. And I love the design of it. The keyboard feels great, much better than the MacBook keyboard in my opinion. It's supposed to have incredible Bang & Olufsen speakers in it, and so I was really excited to hear those as well. But the second I booted this thing up, I noticed a problem. And the problem is this beautiful 4K screen, which does have excellent color, has really strange vignetting on the edges. The edges of the screen get darker, and it's hard to see this if you're looking at a photograph or a video or something like that. But if you're looking at a screen that's just a solid color, I can easily tell that the edges of the screen are darker. And if I move my head around, it changes the color and the density of the edges of the screen. And that's just insane to me that you could spend $2,500 on a laptop and the screen wouldn't have, you know, correct density on the edges. And so what I did was I called HP and I immediately asked for my money back to return this thing just because I feel like the screen isn't very good. And then I listened to the speakers that are supposed to be super fancy, and I don't think the speakers sound very good either. So it was really depressing to me. I was super excited about this laptop, but at the end of the day, after listening to the speakers, seeing the screen, and then also seeing the results of the benchmark test that we did with Adobe Premiere, it just didn't live up to the hype, and therefore I will also be shipping this laptop back today. This is the Microsoft Surface Book. This is the newer one, and this is their Mac Daddy version, which is very expensive. This thing is $2,700. I was shocked at how well this thing performed. When it comes to the actual build quality of this thing, it really is impressive. I love the way this thing looks. The hinge design is really, really cool. I can't say that it's better than a normal hinge, but for the way this thing works with the heavier screen, it's quite impressive that they were able to pull this off. The keyboard on this thing is fantastic. I love the feeling of it. It's also very quiet, if that's important to you. The touchpad feels great. It obviously doesn't work as well as a MacBook, but I love the way that it feels. And obviously what you're paying for with this machine is the ability to remove the top. All you have to do is press this button and it will detach the screen. And as you can see, you have like a really powerful computer in the form factor of a tablet, which is really cool. Now, to be perfectly honest with you guys, I've had two Surface Books now for a while, since they came out. And I have never once taken the top off of the keyboard unless I'm showing somebody how cool it is that I can do that. Like, there's no situation in my everyday working life where I want to take the screen off of my keyboard. So you have to keep that in mind. If you're the type of person that does want to do that, or you're the type of person that wants to draw on this thing, there's absolutely no comparison. There's no competition out there. Go out and buy it today. But if you're the type of person like me who just wants a laptop to work off of, you may be spending a premium for features like this that you may not actually use. Now, when it came to the actual Adobe Premiere test that we did, I was shocked at how well this computer did. I thought because it was a dual core processor computer, I thought there was no way it was going to come close to beating any of the other four computers. But for some reason I was wrong. This thing really did hold its own in that test, and it even beat the MacBook Pro 15 inch, which of course it wasn't even close to being able to do with my first test that I did over a year ago at this point. So I was really impressed with this machine, and if you're in the market for something like this, I highly suggest it. So guys, at the end of the day, I think we've learned that newer and more expensive does not always mean that it's better and faster, and therefore I am going back to our tried and true method, which is the Dell XPS 15. I have been happy with this computer, other than its lack of Ethernet, for quite a while now, and I think we figured out a way to get around the Ethernet issues that we've had. We recently bought a Dell Thunderbolt to USB adapter, and that thing seems to be working reliably for us, and it doesn't block any of our other standard USB jacks on this machine, which has been really great for us. Basically, this computer, other than its lack of an Ethernet cable, is the complete package for us. It's a small form factor, it has a great keyboard and mouse, the screen on it is absolutely incredible, and it happens to also be the fastest laptop that we've tested. I can't believe that that's the way it worked out, but that is the way it worked out, and therefore, I just went on eBay, I bought another one of these things. I'm always looking for the newest, hottest technology. I want computers that are smaller and faster and better in every way. It just turns out that at this point, because of what Intel's been doing with their new processors, an older computer might actually still be the best. And Intel really needs to step up their game if they want to keep cornering this market, because I think people are getting tired of spending significantly more money for these newer computers with newer processors. And in some cases, as we've proven, we're actually getting worse performance with the newer machines. Hopefully, with the new i9 chips and with whatever Intel's coming out with in the near future, there will be much more significant jumps in performance.